Hey guys, so today we are going to talk about the valence bond theory. Now, if you're a little bit confused or out of the picture, let me just tell you, this is a video in a series of lectures where we are discussing how to calculate and find out molecular geometry. Why do we want molecular geometry? Because we know obviously how do atoms react, but we do not know where the electrons are in these molecules, what shape these takes, right? Are electrons distributed equally or not? Now, we said that to understand this, we need the VSEPR theory. If you missed out those videos, the links are appearing in the description. You can quickly check them out. Now, VSEPR theory only tells you about the distribution of electrons in the bonds that an atom forms in a molecule and about the placement of atoms, right? But the question is, how did the bonding take place? To this, the answer lies in quantum mechanics, because both electrons and atoms are quantum particles. They behave both as a wave and a particle, right? So we use quantum mechanics to describe their positions more accurately. Towards that end, we use the valence bond theory, right? And let's get started with that. So, what does valence bond theory say? Valence bond theory says that a bond is formed when two orbitals of two atoms overlap. So let's say an atom 1s, which is spherical, 1s1, I am talking about hydrogen, obviously hydrogen's atomic number is 1, and then there's another spherical, this is slightly oval, but remember this is spherical I'm trying to draw. So 1s1, again a hydrogen. So these spherical atoms are going to somewhat overlap. So if I want to describe it like this, I'll say that these are going to overlap, right? So this overlap, by overlapping, a bond is formed. Now, obviously you can kind of imagine, the better the overlap, the strength of this bond we have been talking about is directly proportional to how good is the overlap we are talking about. Okay, now one electron was here, one electron was here. And remember, what is an orbital? Orbital is a rough area, region of space where you have a probability of finding the electron. Now, since these are overlapping, the total number of electrons in such orbitals has to be 2. Now, for hydrogen, it's pretty simple, right? Now, let's talk about a molecule such as CH4. So, we talk about the central atom, carbon, the atomic number is 6, 1s2, 2s2, 2p2. Now, definitely what you can see here is the completely filled s2 orbitals, 2s orbital, I mean, and then 2p orbitals are filled in such a manner that there are only 2 electrons. But this only leaves a scope for an entry here and here. What does that mean? That the valency can only be 2. While it looks like this, a compound or a species such as CH2 rarely exists. It's very, very reactive and it's very difficult to isolate. The reason being the rules of the stability. Now, if somehow this electron could be promoted to this orbital, the resulting orbitals kind of looks a lot more stable, because the rule says half filled or full filled, right? So S is half, P is half, P has 3 out of total capacity, that's 6. So this is more sort of stable. So that is why this promotion happens. But remember, this promotion requires energy, but the energy supplied or required here is more than what would be now released when we have a formation of 4 bonds rather than 2. So these extra two bonds, energy that's released, that's more than this, right? So we clearly see we have one 2s orbital that is going to, you know, form a bond, and three p orbitals, I mean, three orbitals of 2p. So let me write 2p just to avoid any confusion, that are going to, overlap with four 1s orbitals of hydrogen. Now, well, s is spherical, as we know. So the s overlaps would be fairly easy and kind of very strong. Now, the orbitals overlap in the zones where there is a protrusion. Now, you know, the p orbitals are somewhat like this. So they, we have a px, we have a py, we have a pz. Now, what is x, y, and z? They are axis, right? So we have an x-axis, y-axis, and z-axis, basically the three dimensions here we are talking about. Now, obviously, that means that the four bonds, CH bonds that we are talking about, are going to be different. If this is how we are going to do the overlap, the overlap between S and S, then S and PX, S and PY, S and PZ, they are going to be very different from each other. But as it happens, that is not the case. Experimentally, all the four CH bonds in CH4 are identical, meaning that we cannot explain the experiment by this approach. What does that mean? That means that these s and p orbitals must undergo some change by which they become similar to each other. And as it so happens that it does. So they rather form of something that we call as hybrid orbitals, or orbital formed by mixing the same type. Now, because 1s and 3p orbitals are involved, we say they are sp3 orbitals. If 1s and 2p orbital was involved, we would have said it's an sp2 hybrid orbital, right? So the total number of orbitals must be equal to the number of orbitals involved. So we have 1s and 3p in this case. So that is why we will say that we have four sp3 orbital hybrid orbitals which are involved in the bonding. This is the concept of valence bond theory. And in our explanation ahead, that is what we have to do. We will have to follow the same steps we did for the VSEPR. We have to write down the Lewis formula. We have to count down the total number of electron groups on the central atom and arrange them according to the VSEPR. That means minimum repulsion. Arrange the electron group so that there's minimum repulsion. And finally, we have to find the bonded atoms. But after that, we have to include one extra step, which says we have to determine the hybrid orbitals, and we have to determine the overlap of these orbitals and the orbital that contains the lone pair of the valence shell electrons of the central atoms. So let's go and do that for BeCl2. Now remember, again, I want to stress here, Be is an exception to octet rule. If you want more explanation of that, if you did not check out video, check out the exceptions to octet rule video. Link is in the description, right? Now, Be, we have 1s2, 2s2. S is filled, it cannot participate unless it promotes itself. So this is the promoted energy level. So that is 2s1, 2p1. So we have two orbitals involved, one 2s orbital and one 2p orbital involved. Now remember, 2s is the orbital type, 1 is a number, right? So we have to say that they are going to form two sp, one s and one p, right? So two sp orbital, they are going to form two sp, let me write here, not just orbital, let me write here, two sp hybrid orbital, and the remaining is going to remain same. Remaining two are going to remain same, right? Now these sp orbitals are going to combine or overlap with the Cl, right? BeCl2 chlorine, if you remember, is 17. 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, that's 10. That next is 3s2, 12, 3p5, right? So they have to overlap with 3p orbital. Now, remember, the original 2s orbital would be somewhat like this. The original 2p orbital would be somewhat like this. But now, because we have hybrid orbitals, so let me represent the sp orbitals as a one-sided dumbbell. So it's somewhat like one lobe is bigger than the other, and these are equally shaped, right? These are normal p orbitals, right? So the BE, the orbitals, are going to look like somewhat like this. The BE hybrid orbitals that are going to bond are somewhat look like this. The chlorine p orbitals are going to be, again, symmetrical, very much, right? And this overlap here stands for the BeCl bond. Now you can clearly justify that they are equal, they are equivalent, because both of the orbitals that are combining are actually sp orbitals and not one is an s and one is a p. I hope this makes sense. Now I want you to try to do the same exercise for some of the molecules such as BF3, H2O and XeF4. Remember, before you start with the valence bond theory, you must completely understand how to determine their molecular structure using the VSEPR. So if you haven't already done that, you already know that this is the third video in the sequence, and hence you should watch their VSEPR videos, and then you should try the structures for the valence bond theory.
We hope you like this video. Press subscribe, thumbs up, and stay geekly.